Well, good evening and praise the Lord. And it's a joy to be together, even if we're only together on Zoom or Facebook. Still, by the Spirit of God, we're together. And we've been seeing yesterday, and we'll see today and tonight and tomorrow, how the author of the book of Hebrews used athletic imagery to represent what the Christian life is like. Now, I am not an athlete, and any of you who have been unfortunate enough to have had me on your volleyball team when you were a student know that I am telling the truth. I'm not an athlete, and I'm not a runner. You know, I ran one race when I was in high school, just one, and I was the tail and not the head. And the details are too painful to talk about. But after that, I hung up my running shoes forever. So to find out about sports and athletics, I recently talked to my daughter, Esther, because she was the athlete in our family when she was in high school. And we were remembering when she was in high school and she played on the soccer and the rugby teams. And her soccer team actually won the Alaska Cup here in the Alaska Cup competition here in Manila. And then she went to Thailand with her rugby team to compete there. Now, she said she enjoyed soccer, but that rugby was not really fun. Because in rugby, you get beat up, you're exhausted, people jump on you. You're bruised, you're dehydrated. It demands every bit of your physical energy and your concentration. And then it demands even more than what you have. But she said, what is fun is the competition. You have a goal in mind. You want to win, and you want your team to win. You have a placement, you have a ranking that you want to reach. And you want to achieve your goal of winning while inspiring and pleasing the people who have come to see you in the bleachers. You want to inspire them because they have come to cheer you on. They believe in you. They believe that you can win. They believe that you will do your best. So you want to do your best and inspire them. You don't want to disappoint the onlookers. And also, you have a team that you don't want to let down. Now, the team believes in each other. And so they call to each other and they shout to each other and they yell to each other things like this. One of my teammates is sleeping. It's okay, I don't have any place to go, I live here. Okay. They shout things like this.
You can go on, you can go on.
And they shout things like this.
Keep going.
And they shout to each other things like this.
Get up. Get up. Get up.
Amen. That's one of my favorite. When you're down, your teammates say to you, get up. Get up. Get up. That's the whole purpose of encouragement, to encourage us to get up, to keep going, to press on. But most importantly, she said, my daughter said, is that you have a coach, and that coach would tell you that you could do it. Now, he would say you can do your best, you're going to win, and you respect your coach, you trust your coach, and even if you don't feel that you could keep going, when your coach says to you, you can do it, you do it. Because you know your coach knows what he's talking about. And you need to believe in yourself. Although I'll tell you, Sometimes you will not believe in yourself. Sometimes you will not believe that you can win or achieve your goal. But your coach believes in you. And when he says to you, you can win, you can do it, you do it. Now, the author of the book of Hebrews doesn't use soccer or rugby as an example, but he does use a long-distance race. It's not a 100-meter dash. It's not a jog around the block. It's not a stroll through the park. It's not a 100-meter dash. It's a long-distance marathon that goes on and on and on. And it requires our absolute dedication and dependence upon the one who has called us to the starting line. And in that athletic metaphor in Hebrews 12:1, the author used the words that Pastor Edwin already read. We've already heard this. But let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. And now when we look at this in the Greek language in which it was written, we find that it has layers of meaning to it. That word run literally means to exert yourself, to strive hard, to spend all of your strength and energy to obtain something. So it's not just running for the sake of running. It's running through difficulties, through dangers, through challenges in order to attain something. And in this case, it's to attain the prize at the end of the race. So the writer of Hebrews said, run with all of your effort, and that takes perseverance. Now, that Greek word for perseverance means cheerful, hopeful endurance, patient continuance, steadfastness, constancy. And the Greek word for race, I'm not sure I like this one very much, but it's here. The Greek word for race is agon. Does that sound familiar to you? Does that sound like a word that we hear sometimes in English? Literally, the author said, let us run the agona. Now, that word sounds like something we've heard of. There's an English word we get from this Greek word for race, and that word is agony. But it doesn't mean a useless, senseless agony of pain. No, it means any difficult struggle, any contest, any fight that when you win will lead to a tremendous celebration at the end. And that word agon or agony is only used 4 times in the New Testament. The Apostle Paul used it 3 times. The writer of Hebrews used it once. And in 1 Timothy 6:12, Paul wrote this to Timothy. He said, fight the good fight of faith. Now, literally, he said, agonize through, strive to attain, endeavor to accomplish. The beautiful, precious, magnificent, noble, praiseworthy, valuable agony of faith. Agonize through the magnificent agony of faith. Now, Paul certainly did not underestimate the challenges, but he also did not exaggerate the glory at the end of the race. In Romans 8:18, Paul wrote this, I am sure that our suffering now cannot be compared to the shining greatness that he is going to give us. And in 2 Corinthians 4:16 through 18, he said, our light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. So the joy of reaching the finish line far outweighs the agony and the struggle of the race. Now, the writer of Hebrews also lets us know that our race or our contest is filled with trials and tests like we cannot even imagine. And so we need endurance to continue on and on and on, because just like in all athletic competitions, the prize comes at the end of the race. And in order to finish our race, we have to run with perseverance. And our aim is not to run fast, but our aim is to run consistently. Now, in Hebrews 12:1, that's not the first place in the scripture where we're told to persevere or to continue on. It's not the first place in the scripture where we're told, don't quit and don't stop. That concept is throughout the Word of God. We're told to persevere and continue on, even back in the books of Exodus and Leviticus. Except when they say to persevere and continue on, they're not talking about running. They're talking about shining. They're talking about being a light. And that's what I want to look with you tonight for a few minutes, to see what perseverance, joyful continuance looks like back from the Old Testament. Now, in Exodus and Leviticus, the Lord spoke to Moses about establishing a tabernacle. And he emphasized again and again that that tabernacle had to be built according to the pattern. And then the Lord went into elaborate detail about the pattern, how it was to be built, and who should build it. There's more than almost 10 chapters that go into detail that say it should be built exactly like this, and this is who's the ones who are supposed to build it. And then there's almost 10 more chapters after that where Moses explains in detail exactly what the Lord had said to those who are going to build the tabernacle. And it had to be built strictly according to the pattern, because that tabernacle was to be a physical representation of spiritual truths. And God did not want Moses to mess it up. So he's put great emphasis on the blueprint and the details. Now, we know that the tabernacle had three sections, three areas to it: the outer court, or the yard, we can call it the outer yard, the inner court, which was the holy place, that's where the priests mostly ministered and did their work, and then the Holy of Holies that was reserved for the awesome presence of God. But the closer you came to God, the smaller the crowd became. In the outer court, in the yard, there were a lot of people, and there was a lot going on. But in the inner court, or the holy place, it became much, much smaller. And only the priesthood, who had been consecrated for the service of the Lord, were allowed to minister in that holy place. And then in the Holy of Holies, only one person was allowed to go in there once a year. That was the high priest. And he had to slip in through the veil into that little room to be in the awesome presence of God, where God dwelt. Now, the outer court, the outer yard, was lit up by natural sunlight, right? It was open, and the sun beat down on everything. So during the daylight hours, everyone in the outer court had light. They had sunshine. They were illumined by natural light. But in the holy place, that natural sunlight was not able to penetrate because of the curtains and the veils. There was no natural light in the holy place. It needed another source of light. And God told Moses that that holy place needed a candlestick. And then the Lord gave Moses details on how that candlestick was to be built, if there was only to be one candlestick made out of one piece of gold, but it had 66 different parts to it. You can count them. And it represented the Word of God, which has one glorious message in it from start to finish, the glorious message of redemption. But yet, it has 66 different parts to it, just like the candlestick. There are 66 books in the Bible. And that showed that the light of the Holy Spirit was to shine from the 66 books of the Bible, giving light and revelation. King David even said this, "Your word is a light and a lamp, showing to us the way to go." And in Leviticus chapter 24, verse 1, the Lord said something challenging about the candlestick. The Lord said that the light from this candlestick was to never go out. Not today, not tomorrow, not next week, not ever. The light of the candlestick was to burn continually without ceasing. And then the Lord told Moses to go out and get the oil to fill the candlestick and light it. Not really. That didn't happen. I just wanted to see if who's listening. The Lord didn't tell Moses to go out and get the oil. In Leviticus 24, verses 1 through 4, the Lord said to Moses, "Command the children of Israel to bring you clear oil of pressed olives for the light, so that the lamps may be kept burning continually. Aaron is to tend the lamps before the Lord from evening till morning, continually. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come." So, when God established the holy place, the place where the priests were to minister, he said, "I want you to put in that place a light, a lamp, a candlestick, a place of revelation. It will be symbolic of revelation, where the Spirit of God will shine on the word, giving light and illumination. And I want to make sure that that light will never go out. It must burn throughout the night into the morning. It must burn from evening till morning, from dusk till dawn. Don't let the light of that candle go out." And the lamps on the pure gold candlestick needed to be tended continually, consistently. And there you have continuation. There we have perseverance. There we have not quitting. There we have not stopping. There we have going on and on and on. It was an everlasting ordinance for all generations that must be followed and kept. "Bring the oil," said the Lord, "and keep that light burning." You know, the outer court, where there were the biggest crowd of people, did not have light at night, or at least not much light. Maybe they had the light of the moon and the light of the stars. Maybe their campfires gave them some light, depending on the weather. But they couldn't see their way around in the darkness very well. And we could compare them to some believers today who, during dark times, difficult times, night seasons, have no idea what's going on or why it's happening. They don't understand the times or the seasons, and they're running around trying to figure out what is happening in the world. You see, those in the outer court only had light during the day. The natural light of the sun shone down on them. But when night came, when darkness came, they couldn't see or know what was happening. But in the holy place, there was light. There was a candle, a lampstand, giving its light continually. It didn't matter what the weather was on the outside. It didn't matter the conditions on the outside or the circumstances of what was happening outside of that tent. There was to be light in that holy place. And it lit up the place. It lit up where the table of showbread was, with the 12 loaves of bread that were anointed with oil, representing Jesus as the bread of life, given for the 12 tribes of Israel. It lit up the altar of incense that represents effectual prayers. And it lit up the way so that the priests knew where to go and how to serve and minister. Without the light from the candlestick, the priests could not serve in their ministry. And unless we have the light of the Holy Spirit always burning within us, we will not be able to see and persevere in our calling and finish our race. We won't know where we're going. Now, in Numbers chapter 8, it says the light from the candlestick was to always face forward. It was to give light and illumination in front of it, just like the Holy Spirit gives light and illumination for the things that are to come. Jesus said in John 16:13, he will reveal to you the things that are to come. And God emphasized that whatever you do, make sure you do not let that light burn out. Make sure you have enough oil. Now, Jesus talked a lot about light. We know he said he is the light of the world. But he also said in Matthew 5:14, we are the light of the world. And he referred to his followers as being lights. In 2 Samuel chapter 21, David is referred to as the lamp, the light of Israel. And in John 5:35, Jesus said that John the Baptist was a bright and shining light. And so when we look at this particular light in the tabernacle, we can see a glimpse of every man and woman of God who wants to know Christ more, who wants to move forward into the mighty purposes and presence of God. Out of the outer court, where there's just natural sunlight that gives light only during the day, and to move on into the place where there is constant illumination and revelation. And if we are going to be that light, if we are going to be able to maintain that light, we must have a constant source of fuel, some hidden access to power that keeps us burning brightly at all times, burning brightly, continually, persevering as we shine our light and we run our marathon from dusk till dawn, from morning till evening, through storms, through difficulties, through dark seasons, through night seasons, because the light of the holy in the holy place was to be kept burning night and day. So when God got ready to tell Moses about the candlestick, he said, command the Israelites to bring the pure oil of pressed olives for the light so that the lamps may burn continually. The Lord said, I want it to be pure olive oil. Now, Moses did not have to go out and get the oil. The people were to bring it to the tabernacle. And the oil was to come from the congregation. all of them were to be engaged in producing and providing oil. Everyone, without exception, was to do his or her part to make sure that there was enough oil that that candlestick would burn continually, day and night, night and day. And that means that you and I need to always have a fresh supply of oil. And this oil that was to be for the candlestick was different from the oil that was the anointing oil for service. The oil to anoint the priest was a special olive oil that was mixed with incense, cinnamon, myrrh, frankincense, all kinds of spices to give it a beautiful smell when the priest was anointed with it for service. But the oil of the candlestick was not to be diluted. It was not to have anything mixed in it. It was to be pure. If the oil was not pure, the light of the candle would flicker and go out. I think the reason that the Lord said the oil for the candlestick must be pure is because anything diluted is not going to give us the perseverance to continue to run our race. Anything watered down of the Word of God, any mixture will not give us the strength and the perseverance, the joyful continuance that we need to continue running our race. So if the oil was not pure, the light would go out. You know, we're living in the days when we will see some lights flickering and go out. Some people start burning brightly at first, but then after a while, their light goes out. They're like a flashlight that's running out of batteries, or they're like Christmas lights, like we will pull out in a few days, and Merry Christmas in advance to everyone in the Philippines. God bless you. They're like Christmas lights that are the blinking lights, and you plug it in, and oh, they're on, and then they're off. And then you wait. Are they going to come back on? Maybe they're not going to come back. Oh, there they are. They're on again. Oh, they're off. And you're not sure if they're on or off. They're bright for a while, and then they fade. Well, you know, there is an enemy that wants your and my light to go out. There are powers that want to knock us out of our race, like what happened to the Brazilian marathoner who ran in the 2004 Olympic marathon. His name was Vanderlei de Lima. Now, after running 35 kilometers, and he was far in the lead, and he only had a few more kilometers to go before he reached the end, a bystander ran out into the race course and pushed de Lima out of the race and into the crowd. De Lima regained his composure, and he continued racing, and he finished the race. He came in third place, and he won the bronze medal. instead of first place gold. But the most memorable thing about that race was his finish. In the end, when he ran through the Olympic grandstands, he was filled with so much joy. He radiated joy that he had finished the race. He was consumed with joyful perseverance, cheerful endurance. And it's like he was not aware of anything else. It's like he had forgotten the attack. He had forgotten that he had been pushed off the race course. It's like he wasn't even aware of having lost the first place gold medal. The only thing he was aware of was the joy in finishing the race. And there are things that want to knock us out of our race in life. We have enemies to contend with. In Paul's day, it was false brethren who tried to push the believers out of their race. Paul wrote to the Galatian believers in Galatians 5:7, and he said, "You were running so well. Who hindered you that you don't obey the truth?" Those were false teachers, false doctrines, trying to trip up the Galatians and bring them into legalism and away from Christ. And if you will just wait one moment, I am going to ask my husband for a chair that I'm supposed to have here. I don't know where my chair is, because I'm going to need a chair. Here we go. Here it comes. You see, the goal is not to run fast. It's to run consistently. And I'm not too fast tonight, but I'm going to finish. Okay. Some of you know I had surgery recently, and so thank you. Okay, I have to sit down, all right? Let me breathe. Will you breathe with me? Come on. You know, in Paul's day, those were enemies on the outside. But there were enemies also on the inside. Like Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 5, he said it like this: outside of us, there were battles. Inside of us, there were fears. So when we're knocked around in life, Hebrews 12 encourages us: get up, get up, get up. Keep going. You can do it. Let us run our race with endurance. Let us keep running with cheerful continuance. Now, let's get back to that candlestick and the oil that was supposed to be provided or should be provided for it. Now, the way that pure oil was produced, we know this, it's by beating the olives. Those olives had to be beaten in order to produce oil that was so pure that the flame would burn with consistent brightness. And we need a steady supply of oil in our lives so that we will keep shining and we will continue to run our race with perseverance. But the thing is, the oil is only produced by crushing the olive. And the whole verse of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 hints of crushings, beatings, pressure, or some degree of anxiety. In order to joyfully persevere through the difficulties and be a light in the world, we have got to know the reality that all things really do work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purposes. We have got to reason that since God has allowed stress in our lives, that ultimately something great is going to come out of it. Now, that great thing might not come today, and that great thing might not come tomorrow or next week, but I guarantee you that sooner or later you are going to see why you had to go through, the crushing that you went through. And you'll find that the oil that was produced through that crushing was transformed into the purpose for which you endured it. It brought light. And then when you shine, you can say, Lord, now I see why I had to go through that. I went through that in order to bring me to where I am today. And that is called glorying in tribulation. Now, the Apostle Paul experienced this when he wrote to the church in Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. In the New Living Translation, he said, we think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure. We thought we would never live through it. And now if Paul would have ended there, we could all go home discouraged. What happened to him in Asia? We don't know. He doesn't even give us one little hint. Not one detail of the circumstances of what happened to him. All we know is that they were weighed down beyond measure. That means beyond their ability to cope up with what was happening. They did not feel that they had the reservoir of strength or the fortitude inside of them to be able to handle the trouble that came. And they thought they were going to die. They didn't think they would make it through. But thankfully, Paul didn't stop there, and he continues on with the best but in the New Testament. He said this, but this happened so that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us. Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. You know, I think the coach, the Lord Jesus Christ, must have said to Paul, Paul, you and your companions, you can do it. Get up, Paul. Get up. And even when Paul thought he couldn't do it anymore, God gave him the grace and the power to get through whatever the difficulty was. Because in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29, our God is a God who gives strength to the weary, and he increases power for the weak, so that they will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. And somewhere, in some way, every great man, a woman of God that you know has gone through a time of extreme pressure and crushing. And I don't mean somebody didn't like their Facebook post and it hurt their feelings, or somebody cut in front of them in the line at the bank, and then they had to wait longer to make their withdrawal or deposit. Well, usually withdrawal. We withdraw more than we deposit. Ah, did I say that? Yeah, I said that. I'm talking about pressure. I'm talking about when you know that you're going through a beating and you know you're being crushed, and then you find God gives you new strength to continue on, strength that you had not originally had, because he gives power to the faint, and to those who are weary, he increases might. You know, 2.5 years ago, while we were in Israel, I tasted the best olive oil I have ever had in my whole life. And that's saying a lot, because my mother was Italian, and I grew up on olive oil. And we always had good olive oil. We had the best that was available. But what I tasted 2 years ago was better than anything I have ever had before in my life. So I bought a liter of it. Now, if you were to ask me how much it cost, I would tell you that I paid 500 pesos for it. But actually, that's not what it cost. If you were to ask the shopkeeper where I bought it, how much did he sell it for? He would say it was 500 pesos. But in reality, that's not how much it cost. Because you see, if you want the true value of olive oil, you can't ask me, and you can't ask the shopkeeper. If you want to know the true cost, you'd have to ask the olive. Because the olive is the only one who knows what it cost to squeeze out those few drops of oil. It cost the olive a great price, and that is why oil is so precious. Little olive, what did it cost you? What did it cost you to produce those few drops of oil? You know, we have to be beaten and crushed in order to have the oil flow, so that the light will shine continually and consistently. And we have to be able to take a crushing. We have to be able to stand up under pressure and not fall apart under stress. And I want you to listen. Some of you have been crushed. Some of you have been pressured. And some of you have been stressed and beaten up. Now, we can't see that on the outside because you all look so good, all right? You got fixed up because you're going to be on Zoom and Facebook, and you're at a webinar, and you're going to see some of your friends, and someone of you even got your hair cut, and I see somebody who did their eyebrows, all right? And you look so good on the outside, but inside, you know that you've been crushed, and you've experienced beatings. And sometimes you have wondered, why? But I want to tell you, it's because every pressure, every opposition, every struggle, every sorrow produces another drop of oil from your life. And that oil produces light. It brings you from the natural sunlight of the outer court into the holy place where there's beautiful, glorious light that shines throughout the night and the day. It brings you to the place where in evening and morning there is illumination and revelation. If everything were calm and quiet and stress-free, without pressure, we would all be in the outer court, enjoying the natural light of the sun during the day. But in a season of darkness, when night comes, we would not have light and we would not know where to go or what was happening. So the writer of the book of Hebrews said, persevere, continue under pressure with joyful continuance, with longevity, enduring difficulties with perseverance, knowing that there is a glorious finish ahead. And let's run our race with endurance. Let's be lights that in the growing darkness will give light and illumination to all around us. Let us run with cheerful, joyful endurance through every difficulty. And let's be like that incredibly positive homeowner who is telling his friend about his house. And he said, you know, my house, he said, there's some advantages and some disadvantages. And his friend asked, well, what are the disadvantages to your house? The homeowner said, well, one block north of me, there's a chemical factory. And one block south of me, there's a slaughterhouse for pigs. Ugh. His friend said, oh, well, what are the advantages? And the homeowner said, I can always tell which way the wind is blowing. We need joyful continuance, perseverance. And our Lord Jesus, when he wanted to tell about the ultimate finish line, the finish line of all finish lines, his second coming, he talked about light and lamps and oil in the parable of the 10 virgins. All 10 had lamps. All 10 had oil in their lamps. All 10 had lights in their lamps. All 10 were waiting for the bridegroom to come, but he was delayed. He didn't come when they expected him. Now, that was not a problem for 5 of those virgins, because they had brought extra oil. They followed that age-old ordinance of God when he said, let there be light, let there be oil, that the light will burn continually. And those 5 virgins brought extra oil. But 5 did not. And their lights went out. So the author of Hebrews said, run the agony with joyful persistence. Don't stop. Don't let the light go out. You know, that Brazilian marathon runner, Vanderlei de Lima's joyful perseverance was not forgotten over the years. 12 years after he finished 3rd place in his marathon, and he got the bronze medal. After being knocked out of the race course, he was invited back to the Olympics for the honor of lighting the Olympic torch for the 2016 Rio de Janeiro Olympics. And he lit that flame in front of hundreds of millions of people who watched and cheered. Why they chose him, of all people, to light that torch, and why they gave him that honor? Well, it wasn't because he had been a first place gold medal winner in his race, because he didn't win the gold. He was chosen simply because he finished. He didn't quit. He didn't give up. He ran with joyful perseverance. And I want to encourage each and every one of you to run your race with perseverance. Shine and let the light of your candle burn brightly from dusk till dawn. Continue on and on and on to the finish line, where one day we'll find the great joy of reaching the end of that finish line, and we will find that surely the joy outweighs the struggle of the race. And tonight, just before we stop and go to the next section, I want to pray for you. I'm going to stand. Thank you. I want to pray for you. We're all running a race. We all have obstacles. We all have enemies, something that wants to knock us out of the race. Some of you have been crushed. You've wondered why. It's to get you out from where you were, to bring you closer and closer to the Lord. We're going to win. We're going to run. And we're going to win. And we're going to come to the finish line as a team. And I want to encourage you tonight to keep running with perseverance, joyful perseverance. Hallelujah. 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 Lord Jesus, I thank you. Lord God, I thank you for my brothers and my sisters who are running a good race, who are running, Lord God. Some faster, some slower. Some have tripped, but they've gotten up again. They're running because they hear a voice. They hear the coach. They hear the Lord of hosts, who does not grow weary, who gives power to the faint and to those who have no might. He increases strength. They get up and they run, Lord God, because you give power to the faint, and you cause your people to run and not be weary and walk and not faint. And that is what I pray for tonight by the Spirit of the living God, for each one, Lord God, who is watching and attending this seminar tonight, that they will have the power of the Spirit of God to run and run and run, to hear the voice of their captain saying, get up and run. I will give you power. Let them know the power of the Spirit of God, and let them know the joyful encouragement and perseverance of the Spirit of God that came from you, Christ, who was crushed in that garden. But for the joy that was set before you, you endured your cross, and you empower your people tonight by the Spirit of God. And we thank you, we praise you, we honor you, we love you, we hear you, Lord God, we hear you, and we thank you for your word, we thank you for your ways. Bless my brothers and sisters as they continue on and on and on, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you, and God bless you.